Homeless shelters are a beneficial resource for the homeless population to stay, but what if homeless individuals have no other option besides public spaces? Public areas such as libraries, private businesses, alleyways, parks, and airports are places where homeless individuals can appear not to be homeless while seeking shelter. Researchers have developed four different hypotheses that seek to understand what a homeless individual looks for in a public space in order to understand the relationship between the homeless and the public spaces they choose to inhabit. The first hypothesis suggests a preference for certain types of shelter that follow homeless sheltering strategies. These focus on protective boundaries, vantage points, and refuge from the weather. The second hypothesis suggests a need for easy access. The third hypothesis suggests that abandoned, unattractive, and uninhabited spaces are advantageous as long as they provide functionality and safety. The fourth hypothesis suggests that homeless individuals are most likely to seek shelter in locations that are near other basic survival resources such as food, medical services, and employment. Among the homeless population that inhabit these public spaces are homeless youth. Youth homelessness can be defined as both minors living doubled up with family and friends, as well as minors living alone in public spaces. An analysis referencing a 2011 study conducted by the CDC, 6% of youth reported sleeping overnight away from home, 83.9% of homeless youth slept at a family or friend's house, 14.1% slept in a shelter, and 2% slept in a public space. Research shows that unaccompanied homeless youth and homeless youth with parents are more likely to suffer from mental health problems than their housed peers. Additionally, as students explore their identity, LGBT middle school and high school students experience higher rates of homelessness from unsupportive families and communities. In a study, 9.5% of students reported as LGBT and 23.2% of LGBT youth have reported to experience at least one night of homelessness. 8.3% of homeless LGBT youth stayed in a shelter, while 14.4% stayed in a public space, and 7.9% stayed in a stranger's house. With research into the types of public spaces the homeless population inhabit, we can move forward to develop safe and available spaces for homeless adults and youth to stay until the causes of homelessness are reduced. Inclusion, increased support, and available resources will also reduce LGBT youth homelessness and assist the overall homeless population until they are able to take back control of their lives.
Welfare is a type of government support intended to ensure that members of a society can meet their basic human needs, such as food and shelter. I'm going to go into the rise of welfare and what problems have stemmed from the use and what programs are currently a part of welfare, welfare fraud, and some of the solutions that I've found. SNAP stands for Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program. SNAP is a federal program that allows millions of low-income Americans to put food on the table.
The paradox of redistribution and strategies of equality, welfare state institutions, inequality, and poverty in the Western countries discusses whether welfare should be universal, state, or even locally decided. Most of these decisions have been made based on affordable housing. Different states have different standards of living.
There is a very much a lack of affordable housing. Hmm. And so it's really hard to live in a downtown area, mm-hmm. because sometimes that's the most expensive place to live.
Yeah.
But yet that's where the jobs are.
Yeah.
And so that's where you want to live in order to make money. But then when you're trying to make money, you're paying higher housing.
Yeah.
And so, for example, you have to make over $15 an hour just to be able to afford a two-bedroom apartment on average in America. Hmm. And so that's, you know, twice the income or the minimum wage.
Yeah.
And so there's a lot when it comes between, like, you know, what you're getting paid versus what you have to pay.
Yeah.
For your housing, it doesn't match up many times, and that ends up having a lot of people in poverty.
Generational situations have become very prevalent when distributing food stamps and money. Single parent or busy parents have an impact on the environment of the child, causing situations to occur that normally shouldn't happen.
With that, and then the generational thing where, like, the parents don't understand, okay, well, my 12-year-old girl has a cell phone and, you know, Why is she taking naked pictures of herself and sending them to grown men? You know, that's a huge disconnect. And that's where a lot of these problems stem from, because the parents just really don't know about what's really going on in the world today with teenagers. So all of us are so incredibly busy in our lives. You know, even though they're mostly Medicaid kids, it's even if it's, you know, not a single parent household and both parents are still in the household, they're working 2-3 jobs and they don't have time to spend with their kids and validate them and ensure that if they do have a cell phone, what they're doing on their cell phone.
Fortunately, education is a getaway from the poor environment during the day. Students can build their academic repertoire and skills that will help their situation in the future with advanced education and employment.
Now, renters' education, you know, what renters' rights are, you know, how to buy a home, how to get your credit score better so you can buy a home, all of these things. But, you know, if these people don't have transportation to get to those classes, they're not going to show up. I mean, they can't. And, you know, that's not going to be funded. The transportation's not going to be funded by, like, their Medicaid like that. And if you don't have the ability to do that, then what are you going to do? You know, and it kind of just perpetuates that cycle of poverty.
In Olivia Giovetti's How Does Education Help Poverty, she states three main ways that education affects poverty. Education develops skills and abilities. Education decreases risk and vulnerability. And education can fight inequality. Like a tree, poverty has many roots, but among the main causes of global poverty, one factor stands out: education. Not every person with an education is living in extreme poverty, but most of those living in extreme poverty do lack a basic education. Those living below the poverty line will also be more likely to keep their children out of school, which means that their children will also have a greater chance of living in poverty. Education is often referred to as the great equalizer. It can open the door to jobs, resources, and skills that a family needs to not just survive, but thrive. There are six major welfare programs, the three on the left, temporary assistance for those in need, Medicaid, and supplemental nutrition assistance programs, help with basic needs such as food and health for disabled and needy individuals. The three on the right, however, earned income tax credit, supplemental security income, and housing assistance help with financial needs for just about everyone, and housing for very poor individuals.
But like, what is the day-to-day person?
Usually Medicaid funded, so we're looking under the poverty line. And they're usually from Roanoke, so there's a lot of gang affiliations, stuff like that. I would say 80% of my clients that I see on a weekly basis have pretty significant trauma.
Okay.
Stems from neglect to verbal, physical abuse to sexual abuse.
Unfortunately, there are some people who use this system to their benefit. Most people work extremely many jobs to provide for their family. Although there is a negative connotation when I say welfare fraud, most people that are recorded welfare frauds just have a problem budgeting or some other situation that is seen as abuse of the system. For the percentage that doesn't have problems like that, the American Journal of Economics and Sociology goes through welfare fraud and their solution to welfare fraud offer jobs. Their solution is just their title. If you offer jobs, that money would be more than what the government offers. Even if they make money illegally and their money and their employment isn't in the books, then they cannot deny the job.
Look at those individuals. I feel like on some level, they still need some of that help. Then there's got to be something underlying other than money. Like why do you need that extra money? Is there, you know, are you not able to budget correctly, or, you know, are you like me, are you feeding the whole entire neighborhood?
From all the research that I had into this topic, there weren't many programs that lift people from under the poverty line. In my opinion, that should be the greatest pet peeve when looking at these individuals. The overlying solution that I found isn't really a program, it's the education system. Personally, I know a few people who were born in a very poor environment, but through education and working their butt off, they found themselves out of poverty and in a very good situation. Similarly, community centers also keep children from getting in trouble, and I think this can also contribute to the generational poverty that is consistent. Specifically, small communities have little programs on the local level that also help sort of this poverty gap between the wealthy and the poor. What we discussed today were some of the problems that welfare helps and what each of those programs were. We also looked into welfare fraud and how most people just need that extra help for different circumstances. Fortunately, there were some innovations that help with poverty and a boost for people from under that line. I hope everyone became a little smarter today on welfare and some of the programs that help.
Where are we at right now? Italy, south of France, heaven, close. We're in Southwest Virginia, one of the most stunning landscapes in the country, and to the people who live here, a sprawling mess of highways, strip malls, and suburbs. These visuals are so ubiquitous that these landscapes could probably be mistaken for any town on the east coast of America. But in other parts of the world, the idea of a city looking like this would be completely unheard of. Today, we're going to take a look at why this became the blueprint for American cities, what this means for us, and where we go from here. Before the 20th century, cities in America were primarily laid out in grids, which was easy for a few reasons. They were easy to navigate, they were easy to organize, and they were easy to develop once the cities expanded. People lived in apartment buildings above businesses in the city, and for people living outside the city, trams made it really easy to make your daily commute into town. If you needed to travel long distances, the train infrastructure was developed where you could take this train in Christiansburg to Roanoke, and from there, the rest of Virginia. This all began to change, though, in the early 1900s when the United States was going through a period of industrialization when factories were being built in really close proximity to housing, leading to terrible living conditions and disease. In order to solve this issue, city planners created zoning maps for cities, which separated cities into different zones, each with a specific purpose. For example, here's the zoning map for Blacksburg, with RR4 representing low-density residential, GC representing general commercial, etc., etc. Meanwhile, the use of automobiles was becoming more and more common, and the federal government saw this as a very profitable opportunity. The government heavily funded the construction of the road and highway network, and this, in combination with the pre-existing zoning maps, led to the development of a uniquely American style of city, where new developments built outside of the pre-industrialization city centers were designed for cars, not people. Instead of maintaining the grid pattern of old cities and neighborhoods, suburbs were constructed for much lower population density, and roads were laid out in loops and curves, which were safer for cars than grids. Instead of commercial areas occupying the ground floors of buildings and city centers, Large shopping centers with massive parking lots and tall signs, which were easy for car access, became the model for most retail construction. Cities were rarely constructed in a way that integrates living and working spaces due to the vast majority of zoning laws prohibiting the construction of mixed-use developments, and this all culminates in what we now recognize as the American city. Beyond the fact that this is hideous to look at, it also results in a higher cost of living, higher rates of economic disparity, higher rates of pollution, higher rates of diseases associated with sedentary lifestyles, and environments that show now more than ever that they were designed to keep people separated from each other. When I hear people talking about a shift to a more environmentally friendly way of living, we often hear people say things like, take public transportation because it's better for the environment, and walk places instead of driving, but these go directly against the design intentions of our cities. In order to see real change, environmentally conscious ways of living can no longer be this roundabout obstacle course of waiting for hours at a time and hiking through parking lots to get anything done. They need to be the design objective for city planners. This all starts with loosening restrictions from zoning laws, but it goes all the way up to getting rid of oil lobbyists in Congress so we can start building transportation networks that benefit people instead of corporations. At an individual level, yes, it's important to walk and use public transportation when it's possible, but if that's not an option for you, then the best thing you can do is stay informed and hold your government officials accountable.